God said, let there be microphone. Yeah.
Good morning and welcome. Welcome to those of you here in the sanctuary and to those of you joining us online on this gorgeous Minnesota day. We do have a few announcements that we would like to begin with. The Unitines are hosting a fundraising community meal today after the third service in Friendship Hall. And when you come back for that, just hang around because right after that, we have our annual meeting at 1:30 right here in the sanctuary this afternoon. If you plan to participate in the Feed My Starving Children mobile pack, it happens this Thursday, so it would be really important to have you sign up before you leave today, and you can sign up out in the garden court. As part of our Love in Action Month, we have a display in the garden court showing you some of the options for serving on various ministry teams here at Unity Minneapolis. Be sure to check it out and see what might be calling you to get involved. And then next Sunday, as part of that same energy of love and action, we have the Unity and Community tables. We will have tables with different partners from our community outreach organizations who will be giving you opportunities to volunteer outside these walls out in our community. Not sure what spiritual gifts you have to share in either capacity in this community or outside the community? Plan to attend the two-week spiritual discovery process that we will begin next Sunday afternoon. It's called Who Have I Come Here to Be? And again, you can sign up out in the garden court. If you are considering membership in this community, we have a four-week membership class that begins on Wednesday, March 8th. More information again in the garden court or online. You know, while out in the garden court, there's lots of flyers about the various activities that are going on here, and there's lots of information under what's happening on our website. Be sure to sign up to get our Peak of the Week. It's an email that we send out through Constant Contact every Thursday to help keep you informed of the activities going on here in this community. If you have your electronic devices with you, now would be a great time to take them out. If you're on Facebook, check in on Facebook. Let your friends know where you're at, that they would truly be welcome here. And then silence the device. Give yourself and those around you the gift of this hour without the intrusion of our electronic media. And now let's give ourselves that gift of prayer as we join together in spiritual communion. Sweet, sweet Spirit. We are truly grateful for this day. Grateful for this community. Grateful to have a place to come to celebrate each and every person here. We are truly blessed. Thank you, thank you, thank you, God. Amen. Shall we applaud and celebrate this day? Yay. We like to begin each Sunday affirming our core values, our vision, and our mission as a community. You can follow along online or on your screen. I said online. That's not exactly what I meant. You can follow along in the bulletin or on your screen if you're online. And we'll begin with our core values. Together, we are loving, transforming, welcoming, spirit-filled, prosperous, and joyful. And our vision together, centered in spirit, we celebrate a world transformed by love, peace, and compassion. And our mission together, we are a vibrant, inclusive, prosperous spiritual community, inspiring and empowering full expression of the divine within through prayer, education, and service. I invite our on-duty Unity prayer chaplains to please stand. These individuals arrived early to hold sacred space, to support you with affirmative prayer. If you have a concern, a joy, something on your heart that you would like to have someone hold in the strictest of confidence and the highest of watch, I invite you to seek out an on-duty Unity prayer chaplain. They would be honored to pray with you. Thank you for your gift of service. If we could all now stand and join together in singing our opening song.
Speak with bravest fire and have the gift to all inspire and have not love. My words are vain as sounding brass and hopeless gain. Though I may give all I possess and striving soar, my love profess, but not be given by love within, the prophet soon turns strangely thin.
Come,
Spirit, come. Our hearts control.
Spirit's
love,
to be made
to
whole.
Let inward love,
guide every deed.
Thank you, and please be seated. Good morning. It's great to have you here today, and we certainly welcome those that are streaming with us online today as well. You know, one of our core values here is that value of welcoming. And therefore, we invite you, if you're here for the first, second, or third time, to allow us to honor your presence by welcoming you today. So we invite you, if you would, just to take your courage in your hand and raise your hand as I raise my hand. All courage, first, second, third time guests. Yes, courage. 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 Keep your hands up, please, until our ushers get to you. Keep your hands up, please, until our ushers get to you. That packet of information you're receiving tells you a lot about Unity Minneapolis. There's a welcoming CD in that packet. There's also a pink card. If you choose to fill out any part of that card and turn that into our book desk, we have a gift for you. The rose is a gift from our congregation so that we can easily recognize you and give you a very, very personal welcome. All of that's important. And yet, one of the most important things that's said on this platform each and every Sunday morning is this. And that is, my dear friends, wherever you are on your spiritual journey, wherever that may be, you are welcome here. We welcome you, we bless you, and we behold the living presence of the divine within you. And again, we welcome those that are streaming us for the first, second, or third time. Can we applaud these guests, please? Of course, we enjoy greeting each other. We do it with a handshake, a hug, a smile, namaste. We ask before we hug. Let's rock and roll, okay?
We are starting a new tradition here at Unity Minneapolis, and that's during this time of February, this time of love and action, we are going to dedicate our team leads, and you will find their names all printed in your insert, in your bulletin. I am going to call the names of those that I know are present here and invite them to come forward to the platform. For the choir core team, we have Patty Shivak, Joey Beatty, Cheryl Lang, Dean Elwell, Jim Schwartz, and Ellie Cochran. For the Flower and Garden Ministry, Eddie Williamson. For Hospitality, John Sotham. For Photography, Tina Papard. Public Relations, Sharon Payne. Prayer Ministry, Debbie Rutledge. Unity Cares, Teresa Belden. Video Camera Operators, Liz Stuck. The Nominating Committee, we have Patty Shivak. This is the committees that report directly to the board. For Development, we have Judy Killian. I don't believe the men's group is here. I'm looking to make sure. The women's group, we have Julie Frenzel Nelson, Debbie Rutledge, Connie Gundy, and Mary Burns Klinger. Have I missed any other team leaders, committee leaders that are present? Our ministry teams, committees, and groups are formed to support the vision and mission of Unity Minneapolis. In a world where most people are already busier than they'd like to be, Each of these individuals have stepped forward and made a commitment to serve in leadership of various areas of our community. Charles Fillmore, co-founder of Unity, states in his book, Adam Smashing Power of Mind, that there is a great need of leadership under Christ, whose banner is love. As a leader in this community, you are being asked to carry that banner of love. And much like the prophet Isaiah, who is asked by God, whom shall I send and who will go for us? He responds, here I am, send me. Today we gather to celebrate and recognize each and every one of you, for you have said, here I am, send me.
In the awareness of the activity of spirit, which has led you to this moment of dedication, I invite you to enter your heart space. And if your heart says yes, I ask that you respond with the words, I am, to these questions. Are you willing to accept this leadership commitment and dedication?
I am.
Are you willing to exercise the duties and responsibilities of your role with prayer, integrity, and care? Are you willing to continually learn to do your job even more effectively?
I am.
Are you willing to make decisions in the context of Unity principles and the values, mission, and vision of Unity Minneapolis?
I am.
We thank God for each and every one of you. We thank God for your time, your energy, your dedication, your love. We thank you for the many, many, many visible and invisible ripples of blessings, which will be the results of your loving service. You are indeed an incredible gift to this ministry. And so on behalf of our entire Unity Minneapolis community, thank you. Thank you for your gift of leadership. And at this time, I would like to invite all volunteers to please stand. If you volunteer here, by all means, please stand. Can we give ourselves all a hand, please? And while we sing our next song, we invite you to be seated.
God, my God, of God. We now move deeper into spirit with the reading of the daily word and the singing of the Lord's Prayer. As the usher brings down the prayer box, you're invited to mentally add your prayers to the box. Your prayers are then prayed with by our prayer ministry for 7 days, and then they are forwarded to Silent Unity, where they are prayed with for an additional 30 days. The word for today is world peace. I express divine love and understanding to all. When I tune into news of terrorism, racism, climate change, and more, I may wonder if there will ever be peace in our world. Yet I am also familiar with a deep peace found in the presence of spirit. Peace begins with each one of us, and I have the power to access it at any time. Through divine peace, I learn to express divine love and understanding to all. I take a moment now to turn off the news and breathe into the peaceful presence within. Here I find a sense of hope for the world. Engaging the power of imagination, I envision humanity acting with respect for all life. I glimpse the realized potential of a world at peace. I know we can and will achieve peace, one breath at a time. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." John 20:21. The word for today, world peace.
As we move into a time of meditation, I invite you, if you haven't already, to close your eyes. To close your eyes to the world around you and truly turn within. And as you turn within, to focus your thoughts on your breathing and allow your body to relax. Allow the chair that you are sitting in to fully support your body. Taking an even deeper breath. And if you feel distracted by a sound, by something around you, choose to breathe this breath into the distraction and let it go. And with your very next breath, carry with you the statement, I am at peace. Breathe it in. Breathe it out. I am at peace. And in this place of peace, I invite you to hear these words as the words of your heart. As I think of peace, I become aware of you, loving presence, assuring me that I am not alone, that I am divinely cared for. Through the spirit of order within me, I allow the perfect spiritual pattern of peace to be revealed. I know that in this very moment, divine order is operating in my life and in the world. I am at peace, knowing beyond any sense of chaos that everything is working together for the highest good. I am a channel for you, dear God. Your powerful healing love flows through me right now. And with heart open, I rest in the silence of prayer and listen. Listen for your still small voice, guiding my every thought, word, and action in the silence. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, God. Thank you for the highest and best. We remain open to the divine will of God unfolding in our lives as with grateful heart, we return to this time, to this moment, refreshed and renewed. So it is, and so we let it be. Amen.
God is inside you and everyone. everyone else. That was and ever will be. I came into this world with God, and when I finally looked inside, I found it. Just as close as my breath is to me.
Thank you. So last week we announced that Rachel and Pete had a little girl, and we said, And so I asked the question earlier today, so have you named her yet?
Not exactly.
So it's been 2 weeks. So and so one of the things that I got to share with some of my belief is I think that you know, the Native American culture, they actually wait for a while in order to name a baby. They wait. And they let the baby kind of name itself, those qualities that come out. So I encouraged just Pete and Rachel, and I don't know how that went over with Rachel, but I encouraged both of you to kind of wait, and you have. And I was so pleased that you were going to allow her to name herself. Don't you believe the qualities, most of the cases, are within a child when they come into this world? That they have a name within them already. They have something to express, and we just have to allow them to express it. That's not the lesson at all this morning, but maybe it was. Okay. So, well, thanks a lot. Okay. So, this artwork is called Desk Art. It was given to me in 1996. And it's been on my home desk most of the time. Are you familiar with Hagar the Horrible? Okay, some of you are. Some of you are old enough to do it. Some of you still read the funny paper. Okay, so what is the key to happiness? Hagar is shouting up the mountain. What is the key to happiness? And a voice comes down from the top of the mountain. Abstinence, poverty, fasting, celibacy. The voice comes from the bottom of the mountain. Is there someone else up there I can talk to? Oh, my goodness, my goodness, my goodness. I am so grateful that's not Unity's theology, aren't you? So as you know, that we're right in the midst of this series that we called, you know, what do we call this series right here? The the personal steps to joy and contentment, these steps that we want to take to joy and contentment in our life. Don't you think most of us want to feel that in our life? Yeah, most of you do. You want to feel that joy and contentment in our life. And so we began by explaining that there's a little difference between joy and happiness. You know, happiness here was some of these outer things right here from some people, abstinence, poverty, etc. But happiness has to do with outer events. Happiness has to do with things in the outer. We receive a special card from our lover. We receive acclamations in some way. So anything, I'm proud of happiness. Don't you love happiness? Okay, so you get the gist. It's an outer thing. But joy is within. Joy is an inner thing. We come into this expression of life with that gift of joy that is within us. And regardless of the outer circumstances, joy is always present. We get to express that joy as well. You know, regardless of circumstances, it's present, and I've shared this as an example, and I'll share it again, that often, even in a memorial service, when we are experiencing grief and all of these things in our life, we still know that joy is present within. And we know, even at some level, that we will feel that joy again in our life. So whatever happens, we know that it's there. Isn't that the good news? Yes, that's the good news. So these steps to joy and contentment, Reverend Jeanette began that series by looking at the importance of letting go of our negative thoughts. You've been to this service several times. You know how important it is that we believe that thoughts are things and that thoughts are creative in our life. We also teach that thoughts actually form the blueprint of our life. So the thoughts that we think today is really about creating our tomorrow. So we began to look at these thoughts, especially these clusters of negative thought, and we began to notice and we began to change these thoughts in our life and create a new blueprint to step into. And then last week, I talked about if we want to experience joy and contentment in our life, that it's really important that we give. That we give and that we practice that spiritual law that Jesus taught so beautifully when he says, give and you shall receive. We also talked about the importance of just not expecting to receive in the same field. In other words, sometimes we will sow something, as Jesus says, we will sow in one field and we will reap in another field. Now, sometimes we really want to put priorities on how we want to receive, you know. I want to share another story with you. I was really new into a 12-step program, and I was living in New Orleans where I came into sobriety. If you can get sober in New Orleans, you get sober anywhere. So I had been just about 2 years in this program, and I had a wonderful sponsor. He's on the other side now, but he's had a wonderful sponsor. And I was telling him, I said, hey, Joseph, I want love in my life. I want love in my life. And he says, well, Pat, you've got all the love that you can receive, that you're willing to receive. And he didn't feel like that way. And so he kept asking deeper questions, as some of those nosy people in the 12-step will do. He kept asking these easy 12, and he goes, So he really got to the bottom line of what I really wanted in my life was someone to take home and put between the sheets. Do you know where I'm coming from? Let's just get real, okay? And we put it some ways like, Lessa, I want love in my life. Well, and he said to me, you know, Pat, as long as you put out love and be willing to express love, then the love that you need will come back to you. It may not be the way you want it to come back to you, but it will come back to you. And sure enough, during that period of early recovery in my life, love came pouring back to me. Not necessarily the way I initially thought it might be, but it came pouring back to me in the way of acceptance, the way of understanding, the way of knowing that there was a safe place for me to be. And eventually, because I didn't put a requirement on what that love had to look like, eventually it came to me between the sheets. Thank you, Father, Mother, God. But I'll probably get emails on that story, but that's another story. So today we want to continue with another step of the importance of what we have to do to experience this joy and contentment. And I believe that third step for me is that we have to overcome any sense of inferiority in our life. We have to overcome that feeling of unworthiness, that feeling of not being good enough in your life. I want to share a few things with you that, first of all, I want to share what Ernest Holmes, a wonderful New Thought teacher, the founder of religious science, he says, this thing we hear so much about, called the inferiority complex, is after all only a mental outlook on life. It is merely a denial that there is a power greater than you are, a power great enough to overcome every obstacle in our life. Is that not great? That power that was in us. But I can remember a time in my life where I do it sometimes, is forget who and what I am. That's why I come to places like this, so you can remind me of who I am and what I am when I forget. Anyway, sometimes that I have felt, remember, whatever's going on in the inside of me is what's reflected on the outside in our world. So whatever I'm feeling inside is how it's going to be expressed outside. And at times, I have allowed others, notice that I've said, I have allowed others, I've allowed myself because of the actions of others to feel inferior in my life. And how many times do I want to go, you made me feel inferior? That's a choice that we can either allow or not allow. But, you know, at certain points in your life, perhaps you're not, certainly I was not aware of that choice. Certainly I was aware of, okay, someone else is doing it to me. Certainly I was thinking I was the victim, which I thought that I might be. But anyway, going back to, now you're probably going, when is he ever going to get to his list about... So some of the times that I have felt a challenge is growing up in a small town. You know, our family had less than. And I often would compare myself to the family on the other side of the tracks that had more than. So I allowed material things in my life because someone else had it. I allowed myself to feel not good enough, not worthy enough. That's one area. And then, of course, the behavior of my father, and often with his alcoholism, I felt that made me feel less than, not worthy, and I was so concerned about what other people may think. Have you been there? Yes. Thank you, God, that you say yes this morning to that, because I'm not hanging out there by myself. Then you know what it's like. You know what it's like to feel inferior and less than. And when I was feeling inferior and less than, it affects every aspect of my life. I didn't want to step out there and be out there. Another area is my education. Wow, I have an undergraduate degree. There's many clergy people I know that's sitting around with Pete. Not, I shouldn't have used the word sitting around. There's many clergy people out there, PhDs, wonderful people. And yet at times, if I'm not, even right here in our Golden Valley community, when I get together with other clergy, quite often I can feel inferior because I don't necessarily have the education that these beautiful souls have. They don't seem as happy as I am, but that's another story, okay? But the truth of the matter is, I can allow myself to feel that way. So have you ever allowed yourself to feel less than because of your education? Or, oh, we could talk for 2 days on this one, my sexual orientation. It was awful growing up in a small southern town in South Alabama, knowing that I was a gay man, knowing in my heart that, oh my goodness, I was not good enough, I was not worthy enough, I was damaged merchandise, I felt inferior. It was a deep, dark, hidden secret that I kept to myself. I remember getting on my hands and knees and praying to God to remove it. It was painful. It hurt. I wanted God to remove it. Little did I know at that time that my sexual orientation was one of the greatest gifts in the whole wide world. I didn't know it then. And I kept thinking, okay, God, if I get married, I know everything will be all right. I never could bring myself to get married in that type of sense. Do you know what I'm talking about? But I was so ashamed. I felt like damaged merchandise and inferior. And then what about growing up in a small town where, in Alabama, in a small town, football is king. You know that. And then in this small town, these coaches, because, you know, budgets, etc., not only did they coach, they taught classes in high school. Well, you can imagine how much fun I had in those classes, not playing football. See, I didn't want to play football. I wanted to be the majorette, you know? I didn't want to play football. So the closest thing I got to that was joining the band. But band, second class place, not football. Football was king. So you see, there's many ways, I'm sure, that, you know, I've described some of my stories, and as someone who says, we all have a story out here, do we not? You could tell me stories about yourself where you have felt inferior in your life. I'm sure of that. In Psychology Today, they made a few lists, and I just want to hit on a couple of them. Having different skin color than your peers. For example, finding out that you are dark-skinned while all of them are white and being mocked for that. Being called names like lazy or stupid, queer, gay, sissy. Being physically weaker than your peers. Being ugly compared to your peers. Always called names by your parents, stupid, idiot, fool. Also, my friends, it has been proven that toxic shame that we take on as children in our life causes inferiority complex. Perfectionism. Someone shared with me in between services about someone in a beautiful way said, well, Reverend Pat, I was just doing great. That didn't apply to me. I had a great life until you got to perfectionism. You could have gone all day long without talking about perfectionism. And has this ever happened to you? You study real hard. You bring home the report card. You got all A's except one B. Someone related to that. And you bring it to your parents. And rather than your parents saying, soar with your strengths, your parent says, son, you can do better than that. You can do better than that. Wow. And then this was a new one in Psychology Today. They pointed out that social media, now I'm really getting close to home, aren't I? Social media triggers feelings of guilt, jealousy, or shame. In fact, studies have even proven that using social media too much makes people feel worse about themselves on average. The author says, I believe this problem is multiplied when you already feel inferior as it is. Have you noticed on social media that some people judge their self-worth on how many likes they get? How many likes? My friend got more likes than me, blah, blah, blah. But yet, regardless of what it is, we can get to that. Regardless, we've all experienced those feelings of being inferior. Jesus talked about it in a way that was absolutely beautiful. Jesus talked about it, I believe, when he washed his disciples' feet. Remember, he wanted to wash the feet. And he came to Peter, and Peter says, what? No, not my feet. You're not going to wash my feet. And Jesus said to him, in essence, unless you allow me to wash your feet, you will not enter the kingdom of God. And where do we teach the kingdom of God? Right here, right now, right within. Unless you allow me to wash your feet, you will not enter the kingdom of God. I believe that Jesus was demonstrating for us not only sacred service, but Jesus was also demonstrating for us that we are equal, that no one is better than anyone else. And so often what happens when we start comparing ourselves to others, that is a trap for us. How many times have we heard compare and despair in our life? So it's important for us, my friends, to realize and even acknowledge the feelings when they come up now, when they come up. So the important thing is, so how do I overcome these? We've talked about it enough. You know, Pat, make your point here. How do you overcome these feelings of inferiority? First of all, I don't believe it happens overnight. I believe it's a process, just like any spiritual growth is usually a process. But I think the first thing we need to remember in overcoming these inferiority complexes is so much what the choir sang about a few minutes ago. That Christ's presence, that divine, is within me, and that divine is within others. So we remember who we are. We are made in the image and the likeness of God. Therefore, the spiritual aspect of me is made in the image and the likeness of God. I am image. I am image. That I am is within me. And so often, we can forget that. And again, that's why we come to places like this, to help us remember that. And then stay connected to the divine. When I'm feeling less than and I'm not worthy, feeling worthy, I go, okay, what am I doing differently? I ask myself, am I staying connected to that divine presence? What's going on with my meditation practice? What's going on with my spiritual readings? What's going on as far as my relationship to spirit? Spirit doesn't go anywhere. I do. Spirit is always there waiting for me to just return and remember who I am and stay connected to spirit. And then stop comparing yourself to others. You say, well, how do I do that? Stop it. Just stop it. You know, stop comparing yourselves to others. When it comes up, just shout aloud, stop it. Because it only brings misery. You must take an inventory and see where these feelings come from. You must take an inventory. It's important for me to acknowledge that I know that some of these feelings came from myself when I was a child. Or my father, or my parents, or society. And then what do? I have work to do, and that is forgiveness. Or myself, forgiveness. Do that forgiveness work to clean the slate so that when it comes up again, it's neutral. There's no negative feelings around it. Do your forgiveness work. And then continue to monitor, as we said in that first lesson, continue to monitor your negative thoughts so you can replace it with affirmation. Seek spiritual counseling if you need to. And always seek a place where you can be heard. Our men's group is a great place for that. It's a safe place for that. There's no crosstalk. A 12-step program for me is another place for that. Yesterday, I was in a small group, and one of the questions in that group was, do you have a place where you can be heard, where you can be listened to? It's so important for us to have that place. And if need be, if it continues, then seek medical help. Either your medical doctor or seek a therapist out. And if necessary, we must begin to remove ourselves from environments that cause us physical or emotional harm. We must do that. So your assignment, if you choose to accept it for the week, is, first of all, remember one other quote I want to share with you. Eleanor Roosevelt says, "No one can make you feel inferior without your permission." Powerful. So, this next week, begin to look at where you compare yourself. What are you doing to feel less than? And then begin to get at the root of the situation. Begin to take that inventory and look at how that sprung up and how that started in your life. And ask the question, where do I need to do my forgiveness work? And then I want you to make a God box. I was recently in a healing session, and someone gifted me this gorgeous red box with positive affirmations in it. And so I keep it on my desk. And whenever I'm feeling less than, I pull out an affirmation, and it reminds me who I am. So on a day when you're having a fabulous day, a day that's just wonderful for you, you're feeling connected, you're feeling fantastic, then sit down and write out those affirmations. I am a child of God. I am whole and well and free. I am perfect. What I do is absolutely divinely guided. You put together, you can pull them right off the top of the daily word. Put together those affirmations. Put them in a God box. And when you feel less than, open that gorgeous box, pick it up, and read that affirmation so it reminds you of who you are and what you are. I love you, I bless you, and I behold the living presence of the divine within you, and so it is. Amen.
The light may flash in.
That's a great affirmation to put in your God box. I am never alone. I invite our ushers to come forth as we prepare to receive our tithes and our gifts and our offering. And if you're streaming with us, we invite you also to make a gift to Unity Minneapolis. You can do so on our secured website. So just take your gift in your hand. And let us take a deep breath and center ourselves in this one presence and one power, God the good. And we acknowledge this presence and power as the source of all good in our life. I will affirm our church offertory blessing once, ask you to affirm it with me, and then silently. Divine love flowing through me blesses and multiplies all that I give, all that I receive, and all that I am. Together, divine love flowing through me blesses and multiplies all that I give, all that I receive, and all that I am. And now silently. Thank you, God. Amen. So we take just a moment and we bless these gifts. We bless the gifts that's been received in the mail this week. We bless those participating in our consistent giving program, our unexpected income program. We bless all of these gifts and we send them forth to fulfill our vision and mission of a transformed world. Thank you, God. And so it is. Amen. A couple of things. This Thursday evening, we as a community will go out and join other communities and work at Feed My Starving Children. There's information out on the garden court. Last year, we had so much fun with this. We had so much fun, and so we invite you to participate. What a great way to be able to give back. And then also, if you consider this your spiritual home and you'd like to explore membership, take your spirituality to a deeper place, we invite you to attend our membership classes, which begins on March the 8th. We'd love for you to come and be a part of that as well. Let's stand as we bring in together our youth and family ministry.
You are walking in the light. God.
Good morning.
Weather. I don't know about you, but I have spring fever. And it's just perfect because our Youth and Family Ministry every year hosts an Easter extravaganza. It's a big event for kids, young and old kids. To come, we have assorted activities along with an egg hunt. And I'm putting together a team of folks inspired to help us create that this year. It's on April 15th. We're going to start meeting the end of this month. If you have divine inspiration about what that can look like and how the kid inside you gets to play with our young people, sign up in the Garden Court. We'd love to have you be part of that team to make that annual event happen. Thanks.
Thank you, Nancy. How you doing?
Great.
Let's know our prayer for protection and our peace song. Together we know that the light of God surrounds us, the love of God enfolds us, the power of God protects us, and the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are,
God is,
and all is well.
Peace on earth, and it has begun with me. Now there is peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be. With God as our creator, family all of we. Let us walk with each other.
Interferes can get the best of me, and self-doubt clouds my memory, and I don't take that leap for fear I'd fall.